Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. And today we are going to paint a watercolor painting from a photo after this guy stops drinking water from my watercolor painting water. Don't worry, that is clean and the bowl is also clean. The color is just not coming out of it. And he keeps doing this, he keeps drinking water before I start painting. And this is a kitten that I rescued a few weeks back. So back to the painting now. I have taped the paper, watercolor paper, and I will give you the link in description. And this is the picture that I have taken a print of, and we are going to try to paint this. I am not telling you that we are going to paint it exactly as it is. We are going to use it as an inspiration. And always take a printout on photo paper, because that way the colors come out perfectly well, as you can see here also. For every painting that I make, I always try to find out what colors are present in the photo or the reference. So here the lightest color you can see is in the shade of yellows, yeah, and then there are reds and oranges, and also there's a little bit of blue. So I'm going to now take out those colors from these Camlin watercolor tubes. As you can see, I've lost the lost the cap for one of the tubes, and here are the colors that I'm going to use: orange, yellow, and also yellow ochre. So I'm going to use a mix of these colors first, because in watercolors you always go from light shades to the darker shades, as I've always been telling you that that's the way that they are to be used, because once you put down dark colors you cannot take that back from paper. So I'll just fast forward this bit. So these are the two shades that I'm going to use currently. I'm going to use a mix of them. They are a very watered down version of them, like the yellow is also watered down and the orange is also a lot watered down. So I'll just start from where I can see the yellows in the picture. Just go about it, don't care if it is exactly like the reference, because I always believe that your painting should be you and not the reference, and I never try to replicate the references. That is just something that I'm comfortable with. I'm not saying it shouldn't be done. Many artists I have seen online that they create replicas of photos and those photogenic paintings, but I just believe that, you know, painting has to be very personal and it has to come from within. So I just keep the photos or the reference as a blueprint or a map or a roadmap. It's just that I don't follow it completely. So here I'm just putting down the yellows and oranges, and if you can spot here, you can see that I'm putting down yellow separately and the orange over it separately, and while doing so I'm making sure that I'm not mixing both of them much. There has to be mixing, yes, but not that much. So I have filled the top section also with just watered down yellow, and now I am going at the center again, because the center in the photo had a lot of oranges. So I am going to try to do that in my painting as well, because that is going to give it a very vibrant look. Now also remember that watercolors dry up lighter, so this is going to look a much lighter version of this. When this dries up, it also depends on the quality of pigment or quality of watercolors that you're using. Many colors that are too costly and that make you go broke, they actually don't lighten up that much when they are dried up. But the ones I'm using are fairly cheap, so I know that they are going to dry up a lot lighter. This is because the water dries up and there's a lot less pigment present on the paper, and then it looks lighter. That's the logic that I guess is behind them. So here I am just going over the entire thing and painting this stuff in orange, and I'm just giving it orange tones here and there where I can see that the orange is needed. And now it's time to bring out the big guns. I have now added scarlet red to my palette, because it's time we mix the reds with the oranges and make it more darker. But I'm also going to include a little bit of yellow in that mixture, in the mixture of orange, scarlet red, and yellow. So this makes the transition easier on the eyes, because we don't want the orange of the sunset to just randomly go red, and we should not see an edge or a perfect line there. That is what I'm trying to do. So I'm trying to create a gradient here so that the transition from orange to red is seamless. So you see, there will be orange, there will be darker orange, then there will be more darker orange, darkest orange, and then there will be red. So you will see that transition in the painting, and that is why I always take a lot of time to do these gradients and these transitions, because if you don't do this, and if you directly apply red to your painting right now in this moment, it is going to create a differentiation in orange and red, and it will not look real. You can do that, that can be a style, but it won't look real for sure, and I don't think it is going to look good, so I wouldn't recommend that. Now I'm just going at the bottom of this orange as well with the yellows. One tip that I want to give you guys is that when I'm doing sunsets, I make a yellow tone for everything, like even for the mountains. If they are, the shadow of the mountains are black, then I will make sure that I don't put black directly on paper. I'll probably put blues first, and that is what I'm going to do for this one as well. I'm just going over the bottom with yellow and then over that with the orange tone. And now I'm going to put down the reds, and as you can see, I'm putting the reds while the orange above is still wet, because I want these two colors to get familiar, and I want them to be mixed properly, and so that creates again a beautiful transition. So I'm going to do this with the brush, and while I'm doing this, just notice that I'm keeping some gaps between my strokes, the red one that I'm making right now, because I want that orange and that yellow to peep through the reds. So I don't want to cover it and make it a whole huge blob of red, and that's the reason I'm leaving some part of it. Also, while doing the sunsets, the edges are very tricky, so if you are not painting end to end horizontally, this is what happens and the edges remain, so I'm not perfect here. But always keep in mind that your edges should be covered, otherwise there won't be a seamless border to the painting. Now I'm just going over the bottom section with reds. I'll just speed up this bit, and here I'm applying the red. Now the next part of this is applying a darker red, that is taking less water and more paint, and I'm going to do this and keep doing this layer by layer until I feel that this is the right tone, or this is the right level of saturation that I need in the painting. And watercolors are the only medium I feel that offer this flexibility. I have done acrylic paintings. I have also tried my hand at oil painting. I'll be sharing my views about that as well. If you want me to share that in my next video, do comment me. Do tell me in comments that you want me to share my views about oil paintings. If you are just started up, then I think I should. I've tried acrylic paintings a lot, but acrylic colors don't offer this flexibility, because they dry up too soon, and they don't allow you to work too much in layers, because the paint keeps getting thicker and it just doesn't work. Watercolors give you the flexibility that no other color offers, and this guy is here again. I don't know, he just likes to walk around my painting. Yeah, no, you can't drink this now, it has color. This little guy, yeah, I think he'll just, I'll just keep him down. Yeah, let him be. I will just continue with the painting. So here I'm just pulling the colors with a little bit of water in the brush. I don't have any color on my brush. There's just a little bit of water, and I'm just moving the color around. So this is also a technique that you can use with watercolors. You can take water in your brush and reactivate the dried paint and move around the paint. If you have a pet, if you have a kitten around, it's more fun doing it like that. So yeah, I'll just speed up this one because the next step is really important. So now I'm taking blue ear. Now this is also a lot of water, so this is a watered down version of blue. If you remember the reference, there was a lot of blues, there were a lot of blues on the top of the sky. So I'm just mixing the blues here with the yellow that I have already put. Now just note that if your yellows have not dried up, then this is going to turn greenish. So please keep that in mind. Don't activate the yellows here. Just put down the blues in the areas that you have just kept yellows to the lightest. So I'm going to do this to the top section and I'm going to share the next step now. So I'm done with the top section, and for the bottom there is a shadow of mountains which are black in color, but I'm going to do them first in blue because I don't know, I have a glitch in my head that I cannot put black watercolors directly on the paper. That is an I don't know, that is something in my head, I just can't put them down. And so here I'm putting the blues first. I think it also creates an effect, a different effect, because you always have that blue peeping out from the paper. So here I'm putting down the blues. So now it's time for black. So I'm just putting black over the blue section here. Now what I'm very carefully doing is I have taken a little bit of red on my brush with water, and I'm trying to go around the edges of the black that I just painted, and I'm going to spread it a bit because the lower section of the painting is a bit darker than the other sections. So we have to blend this black with the red so it doesn't have an obvious a differentiation between the two, because it has to be a seamless gradient like look because it is a sunset. So I'm just trying to do that here, and as soon as I realize or as soon as I notice wherever if there are hard edges being formed, I dip my brush a bit in water and just spread it around so that it softens the color a bit. So I'm going to do this a lot now because we are reaching that stage where the colors are going to mix a lot with each other, so we have to be a lot more careful. So here I am again applying a bit of red in the yellowish part of the painting as well to create a seamless gradient. So in the next few steps, I have just speeded up this process because I'm going to do this again and again. I'm taking the blues again, and here is the painting right now. We have to let it dry a bit. And now the next step that I'm going to do, many people don't believe that this is a good way to do it, but this is how it works for me. I just dip my brush a little bit into water and I spread it around so that the harsh edges that you can see right now, the lines or the fine lines that you can see right now, just disappear into the background, and it looks more softer, and at the end the painting looks more vibrant and more realistic, I might say. Yeah, the colors look more blended together well. So after this step you will see that, but this step wets the paper a lot, so that's the only downfall of this one. So you need to have a very good quality watercolor paper. I have put the link in description for the watercolor paper that I have used. You can check that out. So I'm going to do this till everything blends. Now since I'm applying water, the next step will be drying this up with a hairdryer. If you have a better tool for drying this, do let me know in comments. I normally use my hairdryer for doing this. After it has dried up a bit, you can also skip the hairdryer and wait for a day or so, but it will be very time consuming. So now I'm applying yellows again because I want to brighten this thing up. Since we have dried up the painting, it looks quite unsaturated right now, or less saturated. So I'm going to apply the yellow one again. And as you can see, I'm applying yellow wherever I feel that it is needed to be blended in the reds, and it looks quite better now. I think it looks better now. So now we are going to draw the birds, and I have taken this micron 005 pen. You can also take any micro tip pen, and as in the reference we are going to just try to draw some birds. Some wings are facing upwards, some wings are facing downwards, while some are like in the horizontal position. So some birds are smaller because they are away and far away in the sky. So note this while you're doing that. And here is the final painting, guys. So you can see that it has turned out pretty well. When you frame this, it will look really good. And I hope you guys also try out this painting and see for yourself how you can convert a beautiful picture into your painting. Bye.